Hello. It's been a rather eventful day. It is a Saturday, and the session has decided that we will suspend in-person worship at the church due to the surge in the COVID numbers. Erring on the side of caution and hoping to keep everyone safe and protect them over the holidays. So there will be no in-person worship at community through January 3rd. We're following some recommendations at the Presbytery and following what some of the other churches are doing to protect our congregation members and to take the leadership so that they don't feel an obligation to attend. We will be holding a virtual worship on through the YouTube channel. I'm available if you go to YouTube, that should be on your internet. Your Wi-Fi, and if you put in my name, Leonard B. Morgan, and the number 3, you should take you my channel, which this worship will be on, and as well as others that I have done previously. So let us, there was an announcement made on Facebook, and we are contacting the members as I speak through our parish phone tree. It is a very trying time. So let's gather in worship. This is the worship for December 13th, the third Sunday of Advent. If you need to contact me, there's my contact information, my cell phone number, and you can text me there, or if you wish to email me, you can email me at elbie3@aol.com. And while we may not gather at the church, we still gather as the church. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. As I said, this is the third Sunday in Advent, and typically during the third Sunday, we light the candles for our Advent wreath. The first candle, you may recall, was hope. The second candle last week was peace. And the third candle this Sunday is joy. And as we light these candles, let us listen to the scripture from Isaiah. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Let us pray. Gracious God, we came to you as human flesh, and you abide in us in the Holy Spirit. Fill us with joy, and help us to shine as the light of your world, through Jesus Christ, who makes our joy complete. Amen. Excuse me. Would you please join me in the call to worship? We come to worship Christ, who proclaims good news to the poor, binds up the brokenhearted, and frees the prisoner and comforts those who mourn. We come to worship Christ, who bestows a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit in despair. We come to worship Christ, who rebuilds ancient ruins and restores broken places. Our first hymn this morning will Be Thou My Vision. old habits and new wrongs can rear ruts in our lives and our relationships. But God is able to restore us. Like water coursing through a desert, the waters of baptism continue to flow through us, reminding us that we belong to God and are raised to a new life. Will you join me in the prayer of confession? Merciful God, you love justice. Why then do we persist in wrongdoing and every form of evil? You have given us the gift of your Spirit. Why then do we quench the Spirit among us? You have given us the words of the prophet and the Word himself. Why then do we despise and ignore what we have heard from you? You have sent a light into the world. Why then have we loved the darkness rather than the light? Forgive us. Restore us. Till and tend us as your garden until righteousness and praise spring up. For the sake of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. In Jesus Christ, the Lord has done great things for us. Even if we have gone out in tears, God brings us home shouting for joy. Thanks be to God, for we are forgiven. We'll go back here. Our anthem this morning will be Joyfully, Joyfully We Adore Thee.
Joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love.
Let us pray. Dear Holy One, giver of life and light, as your words are read and proclaimed, illumine our hearts and minds, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, our lives may reflect God's glory. Amen. Our epistle lesson this morning comes from the first book of the Thessalonians, the fifth chapters, verses 15 through 24. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. But test them all, hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of John. This first chapter, verses 6 through 8, and then jumping over to 19 through 28. Listen for his words. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Now, this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of the one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees had been sent to question him. "Why did you baptize if you were not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? "I baptize with water," John said. "But among you stands one who you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. The Jews back then were waiting. Much like we're waiting. While other churches responded quickly, we decided to wait. And then, with more gathered information, decided to suspend in-person worship for the safety of all concerned. Waiting, no one likes to wait. I can recall the most difficult part of Christmas as a child was waiting for it to come. From Thanksgiving to December 25th seemed like an eternity. It seemed like Christmas would never get here. The weeks felt like season. Time seemed to stand still. But waiting has become foreign to our society. A generation ago, things were much slower. But nowadays, it seems unnatural to wait. We hunger for immediate gratification. Symbols of our unwillingness to wait, they're all around us. The lines at the fast food stores, Wendy's and McDonald's, there's always a line around those buildings. And heaven forbid you go to a Chick-fil-A. The other evening we were out shopping, and the line at Chick-fil-A was three cars deep and wrapped around the building. It's a symbol of our unwillingness to wait. These stores boom because we don't have time to eat. How many meals have you eaten in your car? We stand in your line and yell out an order. It comes to us in 5 minutes, which seems like an eternity. Just so we can get back into the rat race. We don't have time to sit down and read a book. The sad side of the times is that there are now condensed Bibles. And in kitchens all over America, there are gadgets to get the meal prepared quickly. I imagine Mr. Coffee started it all. Simply spoon in the coffee, pour a cup of water, and coffee is made before you even have time to find a cup. When we become ill or sick, we want to be well now, not later. Medicine, doctors, and pastoral care, or even love, are often rejected if they're not swift. I, like you, am a victim of the no-wait approach to life. But the truth is that we do not like waiting, but waiting has become a part of our life. We must wait for payday. We must wait to take a break. We must wait for quitting time at the end of the day. Or we wait for the mailman. Or we wait for a package to arrive. And when you go shopping, you'd better be prepared to wait in line to get checked out. Just as you have to wait in line to find a parking space. And traffic this time of year is absolutely crazy. But there are also some serious matters for which we wait. Some of us wait for good health to return. We wait for news. We wait for peace. A scared child will wait for the coming of morning, just as scared adults await for the end of time. An expectant mother waits for delivery. And waiting can be pure agony. It's like the jury's out. An issue with scriptures is that time and time again, God reminds us that his clock is not wound like ours. Time is entirely different to him. We look at life in the seconds, as opposed to God, who looks at it in ages. And so very often, God tells his people that they too must wait. And that is where the story of Christmas reality begins. It began 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. The Jews longed for one who would bring light out of darkness, who would make the blind see. They longed for that one who would turn their sorrow into joy, who would vanquish their enemies. But God said, you must wait. And so they did. In the Old Testament, long before Jesus walked the earth, the people of God, the Jews, were told that a great Savior was to come. There are close to 100 references in the Old Testament, as well as the New Testament. I mention this because waiting is a part of our faith. We wait as God prepares us. For what is to come. Sometimes we wait for that which we know we will never see, but by faith we still wait, knowing that our children and perhaps our children's children will one day see it. Abraham waited for that which he could not see, a son. Moses waited for a land which he could not see, but was promised to him. Mary waited for what the angel Gabriel had announced, a son whose kingdom would know no end. And John waited for the one whose sandal he was not worthy to tie, the Messiah. We wait. We wait for that what we cannot see. But what are we waiting for? There was the waiting that John the Baptist did. The people in John's day experienced a special kind of waiting. When Jesus was a young man in his 20s, John the Baptist was a desert prophet, warning everyone of the wrath of God and the judgment to come. His message was harsh. There was sharp rebuke, especially of the religious leadership. The people had been worked into such a frenzy that they thought John himself was the Messiah. And many came out to see him, and they would not go, they go home to their family and workmates, and they'd talk about John and what he had said. They were convinced he was the Messiah, or he had something to do with the coming of the Messiah. It was close. John said, no, I am not he, and for now you must wait. I came to tell you about the light that is to come. And when the people pressed him to say more, all he would remind them was that he was not he. John understood that he was planting seeds and that the message must wait. Are you willing to do the work and wait? The season of Advent is 4 Sundays prior to Christmas. And for the Christian, it's a time of waiting. It's perhaps an awkward season because we would much prefer to dismiss the preliminaries and get right down to the particulars of the birth of Jesus. But we wait and are prepared. This year has been a hard year for many of us. Some of us have been in isolation. Some of us are waiting for it to be over. And as the numbers increase, we suspend worship. And we wait. We would much prefer to hear as a scripture lesson, and they were abiding in that country with the words of the Isaiah spoken centuries earlier. Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight your highways. But the message of Advent is that we do not have permission to rush God's story. It says to us that for now, we're in a period of waiting and preparation. There's a special kind of waiting that many of us at some point in our lives will experience, and that's the birth of the firstborn child in your family. The firstborn, there's always such a sense of excitement. But this year, our waiting has changed from what we've known. We experienced a different Thanksgiving this year. We put off being with friends and family so we could stay safe and avoid exposure. But as the numbers increase, so do our numbers that we may become exposed to someone who is not as stringent or as we are, or cautious. As we wait for this Christmas, we wonder if it holds the same excitement as Christmas past. Will it still have that same meaning? The arrival of that long-awaited gift, the promise of hope, peace, joy, and love. How will you wait for the birth of Christ's child during this Advent season? Will there be a surge of excitement and anticipation? Will there be a wanting for you to know all that you can know about the Christ? Times are different. But still, we must wait. These last 2 weeks, the waiting, the sacrifices we make, will make all the difference in the world to come. Amen. Let us affirm our faith by praying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We come to that time of service where we share our joys and concerns as a congregation. I heard that Ron DiRico is out of the hospital. He's at home, monitoring his oxygen levels. We also received news on Wednesday that Elizabeth Maxwell had passed away. She's the wife of a former minister here, Bruce Maxwell. At this time, I don't have any information on any arrangements. We continue to pray for those on our prayer list, for those with health problems, for those that struggle with COVID, for those that have anxiety about the disease, for the anxiety about the upcoming vaccine, for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones during this Christmas season. For those that struggle with cancer and are in hospice. Let us pray. God, who restores, you have done great things for us, and we rejoice. So often you have filled us with laughter, turning tears of sadness into shouts of joy. You send prophets who point the way to justice and show the way to you. We thank you for sending good news to us and repairing so much that we have devastated. In this season of light, we lift up in prayer so many who wait in darkness, people who are oppressed by poverty and discrimination, by people wrongly imprisoned. But we also pray for those imprisoned justly. Right is wrong among us and in us. Restore us to you. We ask that you make the brokenhearted whole again, that you comfort those who mourn. And in the jostling and jingling and the cheerfulness of these days, let us lose sight of you or those you especially came to serve. We lift up people who are in need of healing, people who are overlooked or underserved, the ones who were lost, the ones that we have made feel little or least. Light of the world, live among us, full of grace and truth. And now, as the constant children of God, let us pray the prayer that he's taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please continue to remember the church, even though we were not meeting in person. Your offering allows us to continue our ministry and our worship. And at this time of year, the abundance of some and the needs of so many stand in marked contrast. As we bring now our tithes and offerings, may Christ's heart rejoice, and may the needs of others be tended to. Almighty God, receive the gift that we offer with grateful hearts and use us for your ministry in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn will be, O Come, All Ye Faithful.
The soap you shower with, it's because I'll let you in on a little industry.
Sorry about that. I gotta go to that. Where is that at?
Ever get the feeling you're being watched? Maybe you are. Hackers can steal what's on your device or see what you send over Wi-Fi.